Should I start? Okay, so welcome. The title of this talk is Generic Polymorphisms on Steroids, or How to Solve the Expression Problem with Polymorphic Variants. That is some programming language construct that you find, for instance, in the OCaml functional programming language. So, what is the expression problem? The expression problem is an archetypal recurring problem in programming. It means it's a simplified problem that represents a situation that occurs very, very frequently. And it is very, very famous because it is widely used to justify object-oriented programming. So when somebody tells you why object-oriented programming has been invented, it was invented to solve the expression problem, basically. And indeed, in most functional programming languages, it is very hard, if not impossible, to solve it. And what are polymorphic variants? Polymorphic variants is a programming language construct that is extremely natural and simple. It is rooted in category theory again, if you want. And it can be used to elegantly solve the expression problem in a programming language that have it. In particular, the examples I will give you use the syntax of the OCaml language where polymorphic variants are implemented. And the funny thing is that it solves the expression problem, but it's not an implement in a totally different way than the way it is solved in object-oriented programming languages. So it's really not simulating the object-oriented solution with another construct. It's a totally different solution. And it's a better one than the one of object-oriented programming. And the way it does this is by pushing a lot on generic polymorphism, also called parametric polymorphism. That is the one that you find in programming language with generics, for example. So the plan of the talk, first I will start with preliminaries. You should always start with preliminaries. Just to put some terminology of the things that are in the OCaml language. Then I will present you the expression problem. And I will tell you what polymorphic variants are, and I will show you the solution of the expression problem with polymorphic variants. So the preliminaries are just a little bit of knowledge about the things that are in most functional programming languages, in ML, in OCaml at least, and that I will use in the solution. So the first thing I would like to talk about is the principle of uniformity. What is the principle of uniformity? A programming language has the principle, an implementation of a programming language has the principle of uniformity. If every data that can be passed around, stored in data structures, and so on, has exactly the same size, for example, two words. So every primitive data type, every reference has exactly the same size. For instance, OCaml has the principle of uniformity because the primitive data are all stored in a word. So you do an integer, it takes one word. You do a Boolean, you waste some bits, it takes one word. And for all the complex data, like strings, like records, or whatever, are always assessed by reference. So what you store, what you pass around are references, and references are pointers, and pointers are one word long. So the data has all exactly the same size. What can you do if you have the principle of uniformity? Actually, you can do even if you don't have it, but it's much simpler if you have it. Is generic polymorphism, also called parametric polymorphism. So they are synonymous. What is the idea? The idea is the following. If I have a piece of code that manipulates data, passes around, stores in data structure, takes them out, shuffles it, whatever, so manipulates data without using the data, without assessing the fields of the data or changing the data, whatever. They are just shuffled and moved around and applied. Then the code that is emitted by the compiler is totally independent of the type of the data. It doesn't care if it is moving around the strings or if it is moving around integers or whatever. The code emitted will be exactly the same. For example, if you have a principle of uniformity, all data is exactly the same size. So if you just move around, store, and whatever, you are just moving around and storing the same number of bits. So you don't care what is the type of the things you are moving. And that means that you can write these functions that are generic, they don't care about the type of the data, And you can assign a type to them using a universal quantifier. So these functions work for every type T, or for every type alpha. And every time you use them, you must first instantiate the type to a precise data. And this is, for instance, what happens, I don't know, with the generics of Java or C++. You define some method that is generic, so that is abstract over some class T, and then you instantiate it before applying. So let's see some examples in OCaml. As we see, in OCaml, you write your code without types at all, and types are automatically inferred by the language. So this is what the user writes. These are comments, but what I'm putting is the output of the compiler that verifies the types for you. So for instance, I take the first generic example of generic function, the swap. Swap xy returns yx. So it swaps the elements of a pair. Of course, it doesn't care what is stored in the pair. It can swap integers, like here, swap 2 and 3, or it can swap a string and an integer. The code emitted will be exactly the same. And what is the type I can assign? Well, if I have to use a mathematical notation, the type would be this one. So the type of swap is for all type alpha and for all type beta, the function takes a couple of one alpha and one beta, and returns a couple of one beta and one alpha. And this is the most general type I can assign to a function. The OCaml syntax doesn't have Unicode symbols, so in OCaml you write like this. You don't put the quantifiers, and instead of writing Greek letters, you put tick in front of the letter, and you pronounce it in the Greek way. So this is pronounced alpha times beta goes to beta times alpha, and it's the same as before. And you see here, when I apply this swap function to 2 and 3, morally, I'm taking this type for all alpha, beta, blah, blah. I'm instantiating alpha with integer, beta with integer. And what I get is I type integer times integer returns integer times integer. And indeed, this is well typed and correct. OK? So this is the idea of generic polymorphism, exactly as you have in other languages, but with more verbosity. Here is over the verbosity is implicit. The principle of uniformity is a sufficient condition. If you have the principle of uniformity, you have for free parametric polymorphism. It is not necessary, but I will not dwell into this. What is type inference? Type inference is another technique that is used in programming languages. And the idea of type inference is that the user writes untyped code without declaring types of parameters, without telling what functions return or things like that. And the system analyzes the code of the user and infers the most general type. What is the most general type? It means if a function, for instance, swap, can swap any two types, alpha and beta, the type that is inferred is for all alpha and beta, swap alpha and beta, and not, for instance, integer and strings goes to string and integers, which would be a type for the function, but not the most general one. So let's see another example. For instance, if I write this function, f takes a triple, x, y, z. If x is equal first of z, then I return second of z and y, else I return second of z and y plus 1. The user can write this, and the system automatically infers the types. So what does it learn? First of all, z must be a pair, because I do first and second. And the type of x should be equal to the type of the first component of the pair of z. And to y, I add 1, so y must be an integer number. And so putting everything together, the type I get is that 1. For all alpha and beta, it takes an alpha, an integer, and a pair of alpha and beta, and it returns a beta and an integer. And this is automatically done by the compiler. You don't have to type anything. Can this be done? So in the general case, the problem is undecidable, so there is no program that can always assigns the most general type to functions. But OCaml belongs to the ML family of languages that uses the inlay-midlay restriction. That means if you assume that the universal quantifiers are only at the beginning for and not inside, you cannot have things like if for all alpha and beta something, you close the parentheses imply something else. So if you put the quantifiers only at the beginning, then the type checking becomes decidable and efficient in practice. OK, so this is something that ML has. And we will use this a lot in the solution. So it is not an ingredient that is necessary, but if you don't have type inference, the solution I'm proposing would be too complex to write down to verbose. What are the benefits? Well, if you take parametric polymorphism and type inference together, you get extremely concise code because you don't write data, types, declaration, and so on. The usability of the code is improved because essentially, if later, for instance, you change some definition of some data type, it doesn't matter. The compiler is able to recompute the types and suggest where to modify your code. And there is not much to change. Refactoring is very easy somehow. There are some problems. For instance, rarely it could be very hard to understand type errors because all the type errors sound like this. The compiler tells you, look, there is an error here. X has some type S, but it is expected to have type T. So here there is a mismatch. You're using it in the wrong way. And sometimes it is true that it has type S and it is expected to have type T, so there is the error and you have to modify locally the program. But sometimes it's just that he has computed the type S on T looking at all of your code, and so the error is somewhere else, and it is signaled to you in the wrong position, and so maybe in your mind X doesn't have type S nor type T, and you have to understand where, where in the code the real error is. Another problem is that sometimes S and T can be quite large. I program every day. Sometimes I see S and T that are 1 pages long. And so you have 2 pages to compare and find the 10 different errors between them and things like that. But in general, it works quite well. Okay. Another ingredient we need are algebraic data types. These are present in many programming languages. Functional ones. So what is an algebraic data type? Is a recursive disjoint labeled union of products of types. And practically most data types that are used commonly can be defined as algebraic data types. So let's see some examples. For instance, lists. A list of elements of type alpha can be defined as a disjoint union or either nil, that is the empty list, or cons that put together an element of type alpha and another list, the head of the list and the rest of the list. Or I can say that a binary tree that stores information in the nodes can be either a leaf storing some data alpha or a node made of the left tree, the element, and the right tree. Or I can define a syntax of expressions, for instance, and saying that an expression is either a variable that contains a string, or it is a constant that contains an integer, or it is the syntactic addition of 2 sub-expressions. Okay, so this is a nice syntax to define data types. And for instance, if I want to write the list 1, 2, what I write is something like that. Cons 1, cons 2, nil represents the list 1, 2. Hmm? What is very, very nice of algebraic data types is pattern matching that you have in many languages, Elixir, for example, Haskell, whatever. So the idea of pattern matching is that to analyze one input X, you can do a match over it. So for instance, this is the definition of the length of a list X. So how do I compute the length of a list X? I look at the possible shapes of the list. So by definition, it is either nil or a cons. If it is nil, the empty list, the length is 0. If it is the cons of one element to the rest of the list, the length is 1 plus the rest of the list. So pattern matching is very, very compact syntax. And what is very important is coverage check. The compiler knows the possible values of the data type, and so verifies in a pattern matching that you have covered completely the cases. So every possible shape has been analyzed exactly once. And this is very good because it allows to be sure that you considered all the cases while you program somehow. If you do things like with the ifs and else, if the list is empty, I do something, otherwise you may end up forgetting some cases, for example. Last ingredient. Every time you consider a programming language with types, you should ask yourself, what is a typing discipline, if it is structural or it is nominal. In a language with structural typing, two types are equal if they expand to the same thing. So it doesn't care if you define them twice in two different files, for instance. If they have the same definition, they are the same type. In a system with nominal typing, one type is only equal to itself, and the place you define it is what matters, the name is what matters. So if you define the same type twice in two files, for instance, there are two different types. What's the status in OCaml, in ML actually, in the family of ML languages? It's strange, it's mixed. So you have type abbreviations and type declarations. A type of abbreviation is something like this. Type T1 is a pair of integer and strings. Type T2 is a pair of integer and strings. Type abbreviations are compared structurally. So I define two different types, T1 and T2, but since they expand to exactly the same definition, they are the same type. So I can take an element of type T2 and I can pass it to a function that expects a T1. They are exactly the same. But the type declarations, that is the definition of new algebraic data types, instead for some reason are nominal declarations. So if I define twice what a list is, list one is nil or cons, blah, blah, list two is nil or cons, blah, blah, these two types are different. So if I have a list of type list one, I cannot use it as a list of type list two. Usually programming languages either are fully nominal or are fully structural, only rarely they have this duality. Okay, so this is all you need to know about OCaml to start with. So let's come to this famous expression problem, what it is and why it is so nice with object-oriented languages. So essentially, in the next slide, I will tell you what the problem is, but I tell you why it is the motivation for object-oriented programming, because we will see that there is a solution with object-oriented code, and this solution uses all these features and not that one. So it doesn't use encapsulation, but it uses inheritance, subtyping, dynamic dispatch, or late binding, the fact that when you invoke a method, the code that is executed depends on the object. It cannot be statically predicted. And open recursion, that is, if I have, for instance, an object of a certain class that has inside another object of the same class, in reality, it can have an object of a subclass at one time. So all these five features together, more or less, are the definition of what an object-oriented programming program is. And this expression problem needs these four to be solved. So it seems that the only solution to the problem is to use an object-oriented language. And instead, I will show you a solution that doesn't use any one of these. So the solution I will give in a functional programming language with polymorphic variants will not use any of these. So it's really totally different, and it means that you don't need object oriented programming, at least to solve this problem. I think you don't need to stop. So what is expression problem? This is a definition. There are two variants of the problem, one and two. Two is harder than one. So it's the following. Assume that you are given a data type to represent expressions, the syntax of expressions. And you have functions that works on this syntax. For instance, you can pretty print expressions, you can evaluate expressions, whatever. And the problem is the following. You have already your program written down, and now you want to change the type of expressions to add some new forms of expression. For instance, you have expression with addition and constants, you want later to add multiplication. And when you add multiplication to the syntax of your data type, you don't want to cut and paste the code, you don't want to modify the old code. You want the extension to be separate. So that the first one could be a library, compiled, for instance, and you add the new things without changing the old program. The second variant is very similar, but it's more complex. So you have two languages of expressions with their function working on them, and you want to do the union of the two languages. So for instance, you have a language of constant and addition, a language of constant and multiplication. with their implementation, you want to obtain the new language of constant addition, multiplication, and reuse the code. So let's see, for instance, an example. This is again in OCaml syntax with what I show you up to now, so with algebraic data types. So the first language has this syntax, this data type. An expression is a constant holding an integer or the symbol plus holding two expressions. The other language, an expression is the multiplication of two expressions. So these are two files, two different things done by two different programmers. How do I evaluate an expression? I do pattern matching. If it is a constant, the value of a constant is a constant, is an integer inside. The value of something written EY plus E2 is I compute E1, I compute E2, and I add them up using addition. For multiplication, it's the same with multiplication. Now the question is, how do I create the code for a language that has both together without restarting from scratch and custom pasting everything? This is how you do it in Java, in an object programming language. So you turn the E into an interface with just one method, eval, and constant additions, multiplication, and so on become classes that implement the expression and implement the eval method. So for instance, the const class holds an integer n, and the eval method returns n. The plus holds inside a left and a right expression, which have type interface E, but they are not necessarily plus, it can be whatever. And to eval, you evaluate the left hand side, you evaluate the right hand side, and you add them together. And this is a solution. Now, this is written in the first library. I want to add multiplication. What I do, I just add a third class for multiplication, and I can create expression with constant additions and multiplications. So with object-oriented languages, I have a solution. Is it nice? Not really. It's nice if you get used to object-oriented programming, but it's extremely verbose just to say what a constant is. And you really need to be brainwashed a lot to consider that an addition is an object or a constant is a class. It's something very artificial, okay, somehow. There is also another problem. It is too open. Suppose at a certain point I want to be sure that in my program, at a certain point, I'm using only constant and multiplications. In the object-oriented version, no way I can do that. An expression is anything of interface E, and the user can at runtime put inside additions, whatever, factorials. I have no way to be sure that I'm only receiving input of a certain type for some reason. So I don't like the object-oriented solution, and it's quite long and quite verbose and quite unnatural. And the question is, how do you do in a functional language where I don't have all this stuff? So as I was telling you, if you take ML language, for instance, standard ML, there is no way out different from this, that is doing cut and paste. I cut and paste a new type, cutting and pasting from the two definitions of types, and I create a new eval, cutting and paste the code. And this is not good. This is not a solution to the expression problem. Okay? So let's try to understand what are the problems, the reason why in a functional language I cannot solve the problem. There are two problems. One, if my syntax says that I can be a constant or an addition, in saying that I'm an addition, I'm also saying that inside me I can only have, again, constant and additions. In order to merge it together and put multiplication later, I don't want to say what is inside me. I am a constant or an addition, but inside me, in principle, at least at the beginning, I should be able to accept everything. And then later, if I want, I must be able to say, no, now stops. I only accept, for instance, constant and addition. So the first problem is the recursion is closed. So the solution here, well, there is a solution remaining in the ML language that is to open the recursion simply. So the idea is I turn the type E into an alpha E. And what does the alpha E means? Well, it is a syntax of expressions made of two things, either a constant or an addition. The constant holds an integer, and the addition doesn't hold two expressions, holds two types alpha. So for instance, an int expression inside the addition, I can only have integers. A string expressions, I can only have strings. So this is a non-recursive data structure. It's just the first layer of the expression. And how do we eval such a thing? So constant n is still an n. But when I'm evaluating the syntax e1 plus e2, I have to add together the evaluation of e1 and the evaluation of e2. But e1 and e2 now are generics. I don't know what is inside. It depends from the type alpha. So the only way is to take an input, a function, that given alpha returns an integer, evaluates it. So to summarize, this is a data type of constants or additions of whatever. And I can evaluate this expression as long as I know how to evaluate whatever. This is already quite similar to what we had in object-oriented solution, where inside the plus I could have two E. And I said, but I didn't like it, because you have too much freedom. You don't know exactly what is inside. And I would like to say, no, at a certain point, I only want, for instance, constant and additions, not whatever. Well, no problem, because at any point in time, open recursion can be closed. How do I close the open recursion? Very, very simply, doing a fixed point. So for instance, if I want the type containing only constants and additions, I just do this definition. I say that my type E1 of only constants and additions is a type E that is made of constant and addition. And inside the addition, I put myself recursively. So this is a type of constant and additions of constant and additions of constant and additions of so on. So I'm closing the type. How do we evaluate such a thing? Well, to evaluate such a type, I have to tell how do I evaluate the sub-expressions, and how do I evaluate the sub-expression using the functions I am defining. So it's the same pattern. To evaluate an expression done only of constants and additions, I use this eval, and to evaluate the subterms that are constant and additions, I use myself. And I've closed the recursion. So this is already an advantage with respect to the object-oriented solution. I still open it, and I close it on demand when I want. In object-oriented solution, everything is open, and I have no way of closing it. Yes. Yes. Well, no, look, there is an alpha here and an alpha there, and the question is where is the quantification? So the quantification, I told you before, is outside everything. So the type of that is for all alpha, alpha to integers, alpha expressions to integer. It's not what you were thinking at, that would be for all alpha, alpha to z. This would be a function that can evaluate whatever. This is not possible, but this is a correct reading. Yes. Thank you. OK? But I'm not over, because this is the first half of the problem. The second half of the problem is the hard one. That is, in that data type, I only have constant and additions, and I can't add a third constructor without cut and pasting. So that's the real issue. So let's come to polymorphic variants, this new programming construct that is very, very natural. So the idea of polymorphic variants is to decompose, destruct an algebraic data type that I told you before. It was a disjoint union of products of types that are labeled into two different constructs. The first one is labeling product of types, and the second construct is doing a non-disjoint union of types. And if I have labeling of products of types and non-disjoint union of types, I can rebuild abstract algebraic data types by putting them together. But what I get is not exactly an algebraic data type, because algebraic data types, I told you in OCaml, have nominal typing, and instead I will get something with structural typing. But nominal typing is bad. When a language has nominal typing, there is something wrong in the design somehow. So I will get the good design with structural typing. So what is the syntax, and what is the type inferred by the type system? So the syntax is very, very easy. I don't define anything. I don't define the first an algebraic data types by saying these are the cases like before, when I define lists and trees and whatever. There are no definition at all at this point. But I can just use constructors. So for instance, I can say X is the constructor A that takes a string and an integer. The only difference is there is a tick here to tell the system, look, this is the constructor of a polymorphic variant and not the constructor for an ADT. And it works. And the question is, what is the type that is inferred by the system? It must be the most general type. And the most general type is this one. In the next slide, I will explain exactly how to understand it. But it says, well, it belongs to a union of things. One of the possible elements of the union is an A that takes a string and an integer. And then I have a greater than to say, and I can have more. Maybe there could be an A and a B with a different type and a C and a whatever, and it would belong to that type, of course, because A belongs to the union of A with whatever else. Let's see another example. If I create a list M and I put an A with a string and an integer, and B with an integer and a C, since they must be all together in the same list, they must have all the same type. So what is the type of the list? It's a list of a union that must contain at least A of string print, at least B of int, at least C, and it can still contain more if it wants. So let's try to understand better the type. So when the compiler tells me it is greater than A of string times int, there are three possible ways to read the types. One is not too bad. It doesn't scale very well. One is very good reading, and one is a bit misleading. So the one is the following. Greater than A of string print means this type. The type of that expression is of the form for all alpha, the union of A of string print with alpha. So the type of that constructor is generic. It doesn't have a fixed type, X. It has an infinite number of types. For all alpha, it has that type. The second way to read it is more complex, but is the most correct one. It says that X has type for all alpha alpha. It can have any type if the type is constrained in this way. Alpha must be a union of target types, and alpha must include at least alpha of string print. Again, the point is the type of X is generic. It is a generic type. The third reading is a misleading one. It is to say that the type of X is of the form for alpha alpha, for alpha being a subtype of alpha of string print. A subtype because it must have alpha of string prints, but it can have more. This reading with subtyping in mind is wrong, however, because in OCaml there is no subtyping by default, and because the subtyping destroys type inference. And we want type inference because it's very nice, having the types inferred for me. So no subtyping at all. So the good readings are the first two. It is a generic type with something inside. Just to verify it, let's do a test. So this is the first explanation. Greater than alpha of string prints means for each type alpha, alpha of string prints union alpha. And what I, so x is defined that way. What I do now is this. I define y to be x, and I constrain it type in this way. I say, look for me, x, now I want to have type a of string type int, or bad, or beta, or b. The union of those two. This operator is a type constraint. It's not a cast. It's not something dynamics that verifies that the type is good. It just means that t of type t is good if the generic type of t has an instance that is the big T. And that's correct, because if you look at the explanation, the type above was for alpha blah blah blah. And this is correct if I take beta b for alpha. If I instantiate alpha to be b, then that's okay. X has that type. So X has multiple types, but one is more generic than the others, and the others are instances. So from the point of view of the program, it's very, very simple, okay? You just use your constructors, that's it. And the type system must do some work for you. Let's see other examples of uses of these things. For instance, I can write that function. A function f of x that matches the input x. If it is an a, an m returns OK, n plus 1. If it is a b of n, return OK, 0. And if it is a c, return KO. What is the type inferred by the system for me? Well, the function has type alpha goes to beta, and it's written up there. But the input alpha must contain at most a, b, and c. And the output has any type that contains at least KO or OK of int. So it's no longer checking coverage as before. I've not declared a type and it's verifying that I'm doing all cases. No, I've defined no type at all. I just write my code that uses my data, and it understands the type of the data from the way I use the data completely. And of course, when I compose functions or things like that, it verifies if the composition is correct. Another example. This is a function to normalize animals. So it takes an x in input. If it is a chihuahua, it returns a dog. If it is a Maltese, it returns a dog. Every other animal remains noble, remains itself. So what is the input of this? Well, since the input can go to the output, the function will have type alpha goes to alpha with some restriction. Dog is in the output, so it should be in the input as well. And the Chihuahua and Maltese can be in the input, so it should be in the output as well. So the final type is the following. It must contain at least Chihuahua, dog, and Maltese, and whatever else. And it returns the same thing that was taken in input. Okay. All this work of understanding what is the general type is hard to do. But I have type inference. I don't care. I let the compiler do it for me. This is yet another example that I skip. Okay, now, let's come to the end, in a sense. So how can I solve the expression problem with polymorphic variants? Well, I had two problems. Closed recursion I already fixed by using open recursion and closing it later. And now adding a constructor is easy, because with polymorphic variants, I use constructors freely. I don't have to declare them first to be closed or whatever. So this is a solution. So this is the two inputs, the two files I had at the beginning, that defines the two languages in an open way. So the first definition is, OK, up there is something that looks like an algebraic data type, but I'm just is an abbreviation. I'm just abbreviating the union of two polymorphic variants, just to keep the flavor. So the language of expression is a cons of integer or a plus of alpha times alpha. On the other side, it is a multiplication of alpha per alpha. The function I write, eval, is the same I wrote before, let's say, but with polymorphic variants. For n associates n, and to plus I associate the addition. The type that is understood by the system is more general. It says, if you give me an evaluation function for alpha, and you give me any type that contains at most cons and plus, I return an integer. And so there is a set, and it tells me if you give me any type that contains at most a multiplication, it works. So it's automatic. I'm not doing anything. It's a system that understands. I can even remove the type alpha e and the type alpha f from the top, and it works anyway. Now, how do you do the union of the two languages? The solution to the expression problem is trivial. The type EF is just the union of E with F. And how do we evaluate an X that is type EF? I pattern match over it. This sharp E means it has the same constructors declared in E. Sharp F means one of the constructors declares in F. So I'm saying if X is one of the shapes of E, I use evaluation function for E. If it is one of the shapes for F, I use evaluation function for F. And that's it. So with these lines, I can add together two languages, whatever they are. This remains open, but as before, I've just copied it up. It remains open. If I want to close it at a certain point, I just close as I did before with the fixed point. So these two lines plus those lines solve the expression problems. No inheritance, no late binding, no dynamic dispatch, no subtyping, nothing. Conclusion. So polymorphic variants are a natural language construct. They are just unions, non-disjoint unions, that are the most natural construction in set theory, if you want, and tagging of things. And if you put together polymorphic variants, generic polymorphism, type inference, and nominal types, you can do wonders. You can do whatever you do in an object-oriented language, you can do much simpler in this way. And so who needs all the rest, all the other things of object-oriented programming? Nobody, but it's good because they're hard. If you have inheritance and subtyping, you have to give away type inference somehow, or have it restricted in some ways. For instance, Java is not type inference. Scala is, but not completely correct. If you have a static dispatch instead of dynamic dispatch for object-oriented languages, you are more efficient because the compiler knows where the function should jump to. In object-oriented languages, at runtime, you have to discover where you should really jump. So static dispatching is much faster. Close recursion is much better because you can say, now I know that my data only has this shape. So I can do more checking, more automatic testing, whatever. In object-oriented, you never know what is the data you are processing. And the semantics is much simpler, even if it seems a little complex, but actually to implement is very, very simple. And the compiler is much simpler. Writing a compiler for this is easy. Writing a compiler for Java is a mess because of the object-oriented. And really, the final slide, everything has a dual in type theory. So what is a dual of polymorphic variants? Polymorphic variants are a non-disjoint union of tagged values with structural typing and with generic polymorphism. If you dualize it, there must be some programming language construct that is a duplicate merging products of tagged values. A product is a record. So it's the possibility of writing records with fields that are unknown and to compose them. They exist, they are called extensible records. Nobody implements it. They were designed for OCaml, but they were never implemented for OCaml for some weird reason. But you can fake them in OCaml. And this is an example how they would work. For instance, this stat function, I write this, takes a record, takes out from the record the height and the width, let's say, of a rectangle, and it returns a new record with the perimeter and the area of the new record. Was this a type of this function? The inferred type is this one. In input, it takes any record that has at least these two fields, height and width. In output, it returns any type, any record, that has at most perimeter and area. With extensible records, you can do wonders. You can do many, many, many nice things. I'm done.